My name is Dr. Yelena Weinman, and I'm a consultant at Catenion, a science-driven consulting firm for the biopharma industry. At Catenion, we leverage our science and technology expertise to develop strategies that help our clients drive innovation and bring new treatments to the market. This video is part of the Catenion Webinar Series, and today we will talk about the landscape of targeted protein degradation, or TPDs, a technology with disruptive potential in the biopharmaceutical industry. I will present to you insights that represent the current scenario as of June 2021, unless otherwise stated and based exclusively on publicly available information. So when we assess the technology at Catenion, we look at different aspects: the biology, the scope, the technology's value and maturity, competitive positioning and differentiation, as well as the industry's uptake. Just to give you some examples of we look at the key company players, the deals in this space, how many publications, as well as the clinical trial trends. Chemical biology as a field has impacted drug development in the last two decades. And arguably, the key disruption within this field with impact for the biopharma industry are targeted protein degraders, or targeted protein degradation, or TPD. What TPDs are trying to achieve is to challenge traditional medicinal chemistry and tap into the undruggable proteome, which could represent up to 80% of the whole proteome. So let's zoom into the biology behind TPDs. So TPDs exploit the so-called UPS system in cells. UPS stands for ubiquitin proteasome system. The UPS is there in cells in order to degrade proteins or recycle them. And what TPDs do is they use this system in order to degrade a specific protein of interest. There are two types of TPDs. The so-called PROTACs, which are bifunctional small molecules, PROTACs standing for proteolysis targeting chimeras. And what these do, you can think of them as a handcuff. One hand will bind to the E3 ligase, and the other hand will bind to the target protein of interest. And in this way, the targeted protein can be degraded. There are also the so-called molecular glues that are also small molecules that induce interactions between E3 ligases and a target protein. However, these are based on protein-protein interactions. TPDs show potential and advantages versus other modalities used in the pharmaceutical industry, such as small molecules, oligonucleotide, and antibodies. First promise, go for the undruggable targets. Now, antibodies and oligonucleotides have also been doing this and have had some success. But compared to these two modalities, TPDs have systemic exposure and are orally bioavailable, at least for the clinical stage TPDs to date. They also have a catalytic mode of action and are efficient when it comes to the synthesis, similar to smalls and antibodies. It looks like TPDs will solve the challenges of the pharmaceutical industry. Wouldn't that be nice? Well, there are challenges with this technology, and I will discuss this later on. So let's talk about history. The TPD story began 20 years back in 2001 when Cruz and Desais described the first peptide-based TPD, PROTAC-1. It took another 14 years to develop more drug-like molecules. 2015, back-to-back papers showing in vitro as well as in vivo protein degradation. This led to the development of these molecules towards the clinic, and Arvinas Biotech was the first biotech to have TPDs in the clinic, with first interim safety and tolerability results for their two assets released in October 2019. So when looking at the R&D output, we can see a huge increase in the number of publications about TPD. Also, there are specific conferences appearing on the map. The strong interest in the TPD field is also reflected by the number of grants for TPD projects and the amount of funding in both the US and the EU. So, publications, grants, what about patents? We also see a strong increase in the number of patent applications. The key places where TPD innovation is being done is Yale, Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, Harvard Medical School, and University of Dundee. So let's zoom into the biotechs that are developing TPDs. I like to talk about the four key players. They're all in the clinic and they're all public: Arvinas, C4 Therapeutics, Chimera, and Nurix. A few words about each company. Arvinas was co-founded by the PROTAC inventor Craig Cruz, based at Yale, and has now two assets in phase 2 oncology trials. It is the furthest in clinical development compared to the other companies. C4 Therapeutics was co-founded by Jay Bradner, an early TPD pioneer, went public last year and has its first clinical asset in 2021. Chimera Therapeutics secured a huge $2 billion deal with Sanofi in July 2020. And finally, Nurix, also a public company, leverages its DNA-encoded libraries to expand the universe of E3 ligases and protein targets for TPD. Beyond these four companies, there are a number of startups and biotechs developing TPDs. And they are all doing this in a little bit of a different way. So each company has their unique way of approaching TPDs. I'd like to highlight a few companies. Amphista Therapeutics, for example, is looking at non-traditional TPDs that do not rely on E3 ligases, for example. Lycia Therapeutics is looking at targeting membrane-bound and soluble extracellular proteins. Vividion and Cydia Therapeutics were co-founded by proteome and protein structure academic experts. Captor Therapeutics is the first European TPD company to go public. Speaking of European TPD companies, Monte Rosa just went public this week as we're recording the webinar. Yanpix is now part of Centessa Pharma. And Casma Therapeutics and Life Biosciences are looking at harnessing autophagy as a way to degrade proteins. In addition, there are other companies that are getting started in developing TPDs, including in China, Japan, and South Korea. The excitement of the TPD field is also reflected by the number of big pharma deals with biotechs and academia. 2019 and 2020 gave rise to 10 deals in total. We also looked at pharma and academic partnerships. Professor Alessio Ciulli, based at the University of Dundee, has partnerships with Boehringer Ingelheim as well as Asahi. Novartis created a Center for Proteomics and Chemistry Technologies at Berkeley, which is a virtual research center. The pharma's excitement is also reflected by the recent hires, publications, as well as M&A activity. Amgen and Novartis are very interested in the TPD technology. They hired Raymond Desheis as Senior Vice President for Research back in 2017. Novartis hired James Bradner, one of the TPD pioneers, as President of NIBR back in 2016. How about investors? Are investors interested in this technology? And the answer is yes. We can see that by an increase in the amount of VC investments from 2015 onwards. In 2020, more than $1 billion were invested in startups, biotechs, and research institutes from VC firms. And in 2021, more than $400 million was invested in just 6 months. The hype is continuing. Looking at the IPO front, six of the TPD companies I've spoken about went public. And what's very impressive is that when they went public, none of them had clinical assets or clinical data yet. This really shows the high interest within the TPD field, specifically from the public and the general industry. In terms of therapeutic areas that are pursued by TPD companies, we can see that oncology is by far the most pursued therapeutic area, followed by neurological disorders and immunological disorders. And some of the hot and popular targets include androgen receptor, estrogen receptor, and KRAS. Arvinas is the only biotech that has clinical stage assets with first efficacy results. Their first efficacy results last year at May 2020 were disappointing. However, in December 2020, they released some further interim results that were positive, showing that the proof of concept of degrading these receptors, i.e. estrogen receptor and androgen receptor, in vivo in patients is doable. However, to note that this is only early proof of concept and additional data will be needed to fully assess these programs. Both of the androgen and estrogen receptor degrader programs are now in phase 2. Beyond our Venus, the first half of 2021 has also been exciting for C4, Chimera, and Nurix Therapeutics as their lead assets entered clinical trials. C4 and Nurix in oncology and Chimera in immunological disorders. Beyond biotechs, big pharma companies are also conducting clinical trials with their own TPDs. For example, BMS and Novartis. And the types of TPDs that these companies are pursuing are for the most part the so-called molecular glues that I presented earlier. Even though TPDs show a lot of promise, there's also challenges related to them. That includes resistance mechanisms such as cells that actually downregulate the E3 ligases that these PROTACs depend on. Now, this could be an issue, and further exploration on resistance mechanisms will be key to be able to fully unleash the potential of this technology. In our methodology, when assessing a technology, we analyze the hype cycle. From our analysis for TPD, we can see that TPD has been hyped since 2015. However, the maturity of the technology is lagging behind. That's why the clinical readouts from 2021 and 2022 will be key for the field's future. So stay tuned. We hope this has made you excited about the TPD field, and we look forward to telling you more about this field in the future. That concludes today's Catenion webinar. Thank you for watching. Check out our other webinars and publications on our YouTube channel and website. Follow us on LinkedIn for our latest updates, and send us an email if you want to get in touch with us. See you next time!